gentlemen, the good guys of the year 2003, Simon and Garfunkel. I'd like you to listen, please.
What?
Up here, please. You're marching to our drum. Now, the reason I'm rushing this along, Father Early, who's the pastor of St. Thomas, is standing on my left, was going to be here this evening, but he's just been called away. So I've asked Father Early to wait a second so we could have him say grace. Okay, so, and then Father Early has to leave, so. Could you, Father Lee?
How are you? Oh, it's good to have a microphone and to be able to talk about the curtains. But I'll refrain from that. I guess you're going to get all that later on tonight. But I have the pleasure to invoke God's blessing upon both the curtains and all who gathered here tonight. So let us pray. Almighty God, as we gather here tonight to celebrate the good guys of Wilmington, Sandra and Paul, we ask you to watch over them and bless them. We ask you to bless their family. We ask you to help them continue all the many good works they do within the community and also within their parish community, for which we are very grateful. We pray that you'll bless them, bless this gathering here tonight. And as we say in the good old Irish way, may they live as long as they want to, may they want to as long as they live. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Father. I had a whole bunch of Irish priest jokes lined up, too. Thanks, Father. Well, moving right along. Let me first of all welcome you to the KSC Hall here in Wilmington for tonight's honoring of the recipients of the 2003 Good Guy Award. What I'd like to do is, before we eat, I'd like to introduce the head table. The empty chair at the end is...
is that you?
What? I had some good priest jokes, too. This is the head table. My name is Harry Cunningham. I'm your master of ceremonies tonight. Sitting to my left is Mickey Rooney, last year's recipient. He was the 2002 good guy, and his wife Dorsey. Sitting to my right is Paul Curtin. Paul and Sandra are the recipients again this year. This is the second couple to be honored, so honored. The last one. The last time we had a couple, a married couple, Carl and Hazel Backman, back in 1973. And then in 1977, we had a couple, they were not married. And then we had, we don't perform marriages here. 1981, we had another couple of people that were jointly honored. And then 1992, we had the former Jim Hatzey and, of course, Bob De Palma. Now, again, the only other people that were married in love were the Backmans and the Curtains. But in 1992, there was a rumor about Hatchie and De Palma. But since Jim has passed on, I don't think it's right to bring that up. But Bob De Palma's still here. But again, we'd like to start the eating. But before that, there's one little bit of humor I'd like to, in fact, the only humor that's going to be interjected tonight. I had the pleasure of being with Paul and Sandy Curtin in New York a few years back with the Wilmington Rec Department. And one of the things we do on the highlights of the trip was touring NBC. And at NBC, they have this reality TV. And what it is, for $10 bill, you can step before a screen, and it appears that you're being interviewed by Jay Leno. And so they switch back and forth, and by the nature of TV, it's pretty funny. You can also be introduced or do a weather report with Al Roker. And again, you know, Al speaks to the person's there, and they pay the $10, and they show a screen. And a whole bunch of little kids do it, and they take it home. It's kind of a thrill. So while we're standing there watching a few kids, and we turn our back, the next little kid that jumped behind the screen was Paul Curtin. And he put on what I thought was the funniest 5 minutes I've seen in my life, okay? So to show you, to set the tone for tonight, we do have a copy of that here. And before we start, we are going to show it in that back wall over where you are, Mr. Merrill. Now, you might want to turn your teeth in over here so we can see Dr. Callan, Mr. Stewart. It's going to be on that wall now. We're going to dim the lights at a snap of my fingers, something like that. And this is just kind of set the stage. This is NBC in New York. It's still NBC in New York.
It was $20 too.
Special guest weather announcer back in the studio. It's their first day, but I'll be coaching them. So let's get back into the studio and see how the weather looks in your neck of the woods.
Thanks, Al. This is there's a warm front coming in, and it's gone. It's the 70s. Back to you, Al.
Now, that was kind of good. Did you do the national overview?
Oh, I will. Thank you.
There's a whole national report, okay?
Okay. Thunderstorms in the Midwest, but the West Coast will be sunny and warm. Back to you, Al.
Excellent pointing technique. Now, go ahead and do the forecast for tomorrow.
Okay, more rain in the Midwest, hot and humid in the Southeast, and food. Plenty of food to eat, Al. Hey, Al, weather guys really don't care what's coming up, do they?
Well, that's not exactly correct. We don't always know what's coming up, but there's a lot of work going on behind the scenes to bring you the up-to-the-minute forecast across the nation. Now let's see how you do with the five-day forecast.
Oh, the five-day forecast. The week starts out with day one, rain, then some sun, a slight chance of snow, and maybe some hail. How's that, Al, you fat pig?
Story. It seems as though Al Roker has seen this. He did see it. He did track down who the man was, okay? And he happened to find out that the man's daughter lived in New York. He stopped her on the street yesterday and did what, Allison?
She's gonna hit me.
I saw Al yesterday on the street, and
oh,
he... I saw Al yesterday on the street, and we were chatting, and
yeah.
And he wanted me to bring something along to give to you. He heard rumor that you're a big frequent at Dunkin' Donuts, and he thought New York has some better donuts, some Krispy Kremes, and he had a personal message. He said, "Eat these, you fatty." He said he'd send some of his old clothes over to you as well.
Let's eat.
I know, I want to eat.
Who ate one? Did you eat one, Harry?
No, I did not.
That was an eight one.
There's only five.
Track on down, surprise Rocco in the kitchen, say what a great guy he is, good guy he is, and that they did. They got a free meal out of it, and that started a fad, and tonight, Paul's going to get a free meal out of it. But that was in 1967, so over the years, when this first happened, someone said, that's a good idea, and so they wanted to carry the tradition on, and so the way it works now is people send in nominations at a certain time of the year and write letters and, kind of petition for their champion. And it's not the number of letters that come in that sways the vote of the committee, which is made up of former good guys. It's the quality of the letters. And this year was no exception. We had, I think, six candidates. Five of them were poisoned by arsenic at a church meeting. Leaving the curtains. So one of the letters sent in tonight was sent written by a fellow named Eric Brazil. Brazil, he just changed his name, it's Brazil. I hate when they do that to me in the middle of a speech like this. So Eric is here tonight, and we thought that his letter was probably the one that kind of summed up the curtains and their reasons for being considered good guys here in town. And I'd like to have Eric come up, and if he doesn't change his name, we'll have him read his letter that prompted the election of the curtains for the good guys.
Thank you. From what I understand, this is somewhat like the Hasty Pudding Awards, except for I'm not in drag, Paul's not in drag. No one's a drag, so I apologize for that. I'm going to read the letter. It's not a speech, so I apologize in advance. It is my distinct honor and privilege to introduce you to Wilmington's good guy couple. Actually, I put best guy, but I don't know what's going on. Paul and Sandra Curtin. I'm sure, however, that no introductions are necessary. The Curtins are known by almost everyone in Wilmington. And for good reason, as you're all here. Whenever the community needs them, they're there. They are so part of the fixture events in Wilmington that their attendance has become commonplace and therefore ordinary. And while they may seamlessly place themselves in the background of every occasion, they are most certainly in the foreground. They deserve much more than ordinary. They deserve our sincere thanks and appreciation. I was first introduced to Paul and Sandra in high school when I worked alongside them at WCTV. Whether we were on the set with Boston media figures, on the court covering WHS basketball, or in the town hall screening the town election results, they came with much more than a smile. Paul and Sandra bring something to people everywhere they go, and everyone that meets them realizes their love of life and of their community. Sandra's profession as a teacher and mentor extends well beyond the confines of the school day. She espouses compassion, humility, generosity, and her everyday actions. Last year and this year, Sandra assisted putting together the Donations at the Heart program. Through this drive, Wilmington residents donated bags of food to the local food pantry for fellow needy and disadvantaged citizens. Early that year, in response to the tragedy of September 11th, Sandra produced an inspirational and moving production, which I think highlighted the best that Wilmington has to offer. Sandra is also active in St. Thomas Church and performs innumerable volunteer services for on their account. Paul often jokes to me that he's just Sandra's husband. but he's that and much, much more. For years now, Paul worked alongside the Lions Club to assist Wilmington's families during the holiday season. Every December, he sits in his chair and magically is transformed into Santa. I don't think this transformation is magical at all, however. His giving spirit and loving nature embody the very values Christmas stands for. He has brought so much joy and understanding of these often lost values to every child that sits on his lap. Last year, I saw Paul and Sandra's real family while sitting in the studio. Those very children that once sat on Paul's lap are now taking their children to him. And with them, toys for tots and food for the Wilmington Commissary. Every time the meaning of Christmas starts to slip my mind, this event clears everything up for me. Soon after his stop at WCTV, Paul drives his sleigh to his mother-in-law's retirement home. So for every age, Paul has managed to give. And I think if he had a bunny outfit, he'd be out there too for Easter. I'd like to see that next year. What I think is most distinct about Paul and Sandra are their loyalty and love toward their friends. When WCTV producer and friend Rick Aronofsky's wife, when she had cancer, Sandra and Paul immediately volunteered to help Rick create a show where the community could show their support. When Paul's paperboy at his office, Matt, in Danvers was having problems at school and with his parents, he stepped in immediately and offered him a job at the office. He can call it a job. With advice every step of the way. When his best friend needed a job, he offered him one too. And although these teens may not quite realize it yet, how much Paul has absolutely given to them, they will someday. He has been a second father, a friend, a teacher, and most importantly, an inspirational role model. It's amazing to see them interact. Things have changed so much since I was even in high school, just a few years ago, yet Paul seems to keep up with everything that goes on in their lives. He never had the experience of raising boys, as he has two daughters, so he bought a book on how to raise boys. But he really doesn't need a book, he never did. He is taking these two kids off the streets and I don't know where he put them, but somewhere. The same kid who was notorious for skipping school just a few years ago and ignoring his work is now an honor roll student. The other one is switched over, so they're on a cycle. Oh, he's an accounting major, actually. He carries around the Palm Pilot his mother bought him and the electronic dictionary Paul bought him over Christmas just a few months ago. Paul would feel guilty not fulfilling some responsibilities to the people around him, and although his children are now grown up, he has new children now. Paul and Sandra have been a second family to my friends, for the last, wow, how many years? 6, 7, 8, what? Probably even 10, almost a decade now. When I have a question or I'm in the jam, they're always there for me, even 700 miles away when I'm at school in Virginia. When I needed a word of encouragement because things weren't going my way this year, Sanders stepped in and refreshed me with only a few words. And when I needed a job, Paul also gave me a job. Yeah, he also fired me, so. Sandra are the forgotten heroes of this country, the teachers, the fathers, the mentors, and the volunteers, who put their heart and soul into their community and ask nothing in return. You'll find no better good guys. Thank you. Thank you.
Concern for the whole child became a hallmark of Sandra's leadership. At one point, she even engaged parents, school administration, and the police chief in an open dialogue about the needs of Wilmington High School students. Well, let's be real. It was really about how Sandra and I and the other parents in that pack could keep our girls locked in their homes and keep them safe. But as you look around the room tonight and you see our wonderful Wilmington High School grads, you know that the collaboration definitely worked. The Curtins believed in the promise of our young people. Those of us who were along for the ride remember fondly the innovations they helped to bring about in the social life of Wilmington High School. Who can forget Paul and his pal Chet Soderquist, handsomely decked out in their tuxedos, handing off our glamorous daughters to strut their stuff on that platform during the exciting fashion shows. Fortified by Frank Killalay and all his research, Cheryl and Chet and the other members of the pack, Sandra and Paul shared a special event, and this is the promenade night with the entire community. Through the promenade, whether it was taping, orchestrating, reading names, or once again, those guys loved their tuxedos. Escorting the girls from their cars to the school under gigantic umbrellas, Sandra and Paul were there, and there, and there, long after their own daughters had graduated and were a fond memory to the Wilmington High School community. The Curtins were there on promenade night. Whether it was the first senior video, class of 1991, membership of the school advisory council, the Curtins were an institution at Wilmington High School. In the words of Ralph Waldo Emerson, sorry, I couldn't just press the English teacher in me. They helped us to laugh often and much, to find the best in others, to leave the world a better place. And they helped many of us to raise our children the right way, as Stacy will now share.
There were two specific memories that the girls, Jackie Gray, Karen Matulowicz, Betsy Tate, and I decided we would like to mention. And the first are all our trips to the Red Sox games. Paul would generously take Allison and one or more of us girls on Friday night games. We would drive into Boston feeling really cool in his Mercedes while singing Take Me Out to the Ball Game. We would enjoy every part of the Red Sox game, from eating our hot dogs and pretzels to singing during the seventh inning stretch and hanging out with the other season ticket holders. At one particular game, we had a very fond memory of when Betsy was innocently watching the game with Paul, Allison, and myself while Wade Boggs hit a pop-up ball that proceeded to hit Betsy off the head and land in the street behind the stadium. Betsy was okay, and we had a good laugh, but needless to say, we were no longer Wade Boggs fans. Another great memory we, the girls, would like to share with everyone was the weekend trips to the Curtin Summer House in Ocean Park, Maine. We would arrive at the Curtin's house by 6:30, ready to leave for 7. But of course, only to leave by 8, since Sandra, Paul, and Allison were never ready on time. While we waited, we would watch the Madonna concert video that we gave to Paul as a gift one year, the poor guy. He stole it from Betsy. We know he loved Madonna just as much as we did, and we think it got him psyched up to spend the weekend with 5 teenage girls. Our weekend would go on and consist of hanging out at the beach all day and walking up to Old Orchard Beach and Boy Watch at night. Every weekend was a good time, and Paul and Sandra were always waiting up when we came home, usually in time for our curfew, to talk about the night's events, and I think to check to make sure we hadn't been drinking. The memories from Maine are endless and still rehashed by us girls today. We talk about the time we were desperate enough to sleep in a tent in the backyard in order to come up to Maine, because the house was filled with Paul and Sandra's adult friends. That weekend, I know for sure we didn't make the curfew. We talk about the old-fashioned soda fountain where our local friends all worked and hung out. We talked about how wonderful Paul and Sandra were to us and how they always treated us like their girls. They probably thought we were all born to be wild, but we think we just kept them feeling forever young. We want to say we love you. Thank you.
Thank you. Congratulations.
We have a little gift.
Thank you.
I'm so glad.
Moving right along, something else I forgot to mention. The dignitaries in this hall, there are two I didn't mention. Actually, there's four. Two of the daughters of Sandra and Paul. One is the Allison at the head table, filling in for Father Early. The second is Suzanne Curtin over there, the second of the two daughters. Also in attendance is Paul's brother, Gene Curtin, sitting over here. And no party would be complete without, get this now, Aunt Caroline Thorne, Sandra's cousin, best friend, who we call Auntie.
She's not here.
And she failed to show. She couldn't come up with the $20. What a friend we have, huh? Something else I'd like to mention, this is a healthy crowd here tonight, a big crowd, which is certainly a tribute to the Curtins, because across town they're feeding tonight the retiring superintendent of schools here in Wilmington, and she's drawing an awfully big crowd, so this is a wonderful response here tonight. So thanks for coming. The next speaker is the aforementioned director of the Wilmington Memorial Library, Mrs. Tina Stewart.
Good evening, and congratulations, Sandra and Paul.
Thank you.
I'm glad to have this opportunity to tell you a little bit about what Sandra and Paul have done for the library. Every year, a few years ago, we would come to the town common to kick off our summer reading program, and Sandra and Paul came to videotape that program. And they put their creative flair onto these productions. They added a wonderful soundtrack, interviewed the kids, and put Mike's creative animation into it. And they're really great productions to help us promote summer reading. And as well, Sandra Witt and Paul came to the library a few times to videotape historical programs. Especially a really good one was called Times Gone By and Apple Pie. This program really captured the spirit of longtime Wilmington residents and their recollections, and really did a lot for the historical record. And this became a WCTV bestseller. Many people purchased this video and sent it to people who had moved away, and so they could, who had missed the program. And it's a really good show, and they did a great job with it. Now, often, as you know, Sandra would bring Paul to help with these shoots, and yes, and he would come and would not hide that he did have an ulterior motive. He really liked the friends' hospitality, and one of his favorites was apple pie. So I wasn't able to make him a pie, but I did stop to bring him one. I stopped at the Moolah's on the way, and I brought him an apple pie.
All right, thank you.
You have to share it with Sandra. And I do have, from the library, compliments of the friends, a summer reading program t-shirt for each of you. So the next time you come to a videotape, we expect you to wear this. So one for each of you.
Oh, that's pretty.
Yep. There you go.
Thank you.
And so much of what they do is not only for the library, and this is a small token of our appreciation, that you've really helped us promote library services, and then also the need for the library. Their most recent production was called Time for a Change. And Sandra and her crew came to the library and really took the viewer on a tour of the library, showing a lot of the needs that we have and the need to build a new library, showing some of our deficiencies. And that video, obviously, we'll have to keep on showing for a little while longer. So we really appreciate all your help in helping us promote services and the needs for the library. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you. I suppose you're well aware of the news this evening. There was two major disasters in the country today. One was the tornadoes in Oklahoma, which was very sad. The other was our rep in this town, Jim Maselli, hurt his foot. That was supposed to be funny, guys. Wow. Let's try that one again. There were two major disasters in the country. Wow. Talk about dying up here. Wow. Where's Father Early when I need him?
Right here.
A couple of things I know. Jim and Sally did hurt his foot, so he cannot be here tonight, which is kind of, it's bad for two reasons. First of all, I lose someone to make fun of. Jim and I have this standing, insulting camaraderie going back for years. I really miss him when he's not here. But representing Jim Maselli here is an aide that I forgot to mention when I said dignitaries. Now, there's nothing worse than a lady scorned. So she's going to come up and tell me about Jim Maselli and also probably read me out. Her name is Tara Coakley, and she's Jim's chief assistant. And come on up. There were two major disasters here in this country today. I'll be sitting over here if anybody needs me.
What a lead-in. That major disaster, the representative did hurt his foot or his ankle. I believe it was his ankle. He was in the emergency room this morning. The speaker did offer to hold a roll call for him yesterday so he could go up to Mass General for a couple of hours. He figured his colleagues wouldn't appreciate it considering they were planning on getting out somewhere around midnight to begin with. So he decided to go after the session got out and was there till extremely early this morning and was told to stay off his foot for a little while, which those of you that know Jim know that's certainly no small task. I'm surprised he actually didn't come through the door tonight because you can't keep that man down. But unfortunately, he couldn't be here. He did want to be here. He did say you were personal friends of his. He knows all the great work you've done in this community, and he appreciates that, as well as everybody here. Actually, I love coming to this event. This is probably one of my favorite events to go to for the representative, not just because Harry's a great MC and keeps me laughing all night. I go home with some great new jokes. I won't use the one about the major disaster, though. And I'm not that bad when I'm scorned. I'm actually a pretty laid-back person. But I do have two presentations to make on behalf of the representative. Before I do that, I thought some of you might be interested. This wasn't part of my instructions, but Harry mentioned Rocco earlier today. He is obviously was one of the most upstanding gentlemen in this society. And the representative and Senator Tara have been working for numerous years to try to get a handicapped fishing pier on Silver Lake in honor of Rocco's. And the representative managed, I still don't know how, because I was there the entire budget process, minus the meetings I had to go to for him when he was there. But he did manage to get $80,000 allocated in the House budget for that pier. So I thought some of you may be interested knowing Rocco, and we're hoping to be able to keep that in the budget after the governor's pen goes to work. But not to take away from what you guys have done for the community, because from what I've heard, it's incredible. I didn't know you had a job resource area going. I have many resumes I'll be sending you come Monday. On behalf of Representative Maselli, I'd like to make this presentation, and the citation reads, "The Commonwealth of Massachusetts, the House of Representatives, be it hereby known to all that the Massachusetts House of Representatives offers its sincerest congratulations to Sandra Curtin in recognition of," and this certainly doesn't even come close to mentioning everything that we know you've done, but Unfortunately, they do give us a template, so we can't quite fit it all in. We tried. The font doesn't go that small. In recognition of your receiving Wilmington's Good Guy Award and one of the greatest deeds that have the end of the great deeds, I'm sorry, that have made you so deserving of this honor. You have worked hard for the betterment of the community, from being an active member of the Parent Advisory Council and of local cable television to your involvement in the Friends of the Library. You truly are a deserving individual. The entire membership extends its very best wishes and expresses the hope for future good fortune and continued success in all endeavors, given this ninth day of May, 2003, at the State House, Boston, Massachusetts. And it's signed by the Speaker of the House, Thomas M. Finneran, and it's offered by Vice Chairman James R. Maselli. The representative also requested a citation from the Governor of the Commonwealth. He didn't concede that peer on this, by the way. The Commonwealth of Massachusetts, Mitt Romney Governor, Kerry Healy Lieutenant Governor, to Sandra Curtin in honor of receiving Wilmington's Good Guy Award, which is deserving of recognition by all the citizens of Massachusetts this ninth day of May in the year 2003, signed by Mitt Romney Governor and Lieutenant Governor Kerry Healy. Congratulations, Sandra.
Thank you very much.
I have one more, actually two, technically. The citation is for Paul, and it reads, the Commonwealth of Massachusetts, the House of Representatives, be it hereby known to all that the Massachusetts House of Representatives offers its sincerest congratulations to Paul Curtin in recognition of your receiving Wilmington's Good Guy Award and of the great deeds that have made you so deserving of this honor. You have dedicated yourself to bringing happiness and encouragement to children's lives. From mentoring children to playing Santa during Christmas time, you truly are a good guy. The entire membership extends its very best wishes and expresses the hope for future good fortune and continued success in all endeavors, given this ninth day of May, 2003, at the State House, Boston, Massachusetts, signed by Thomas M. Finneran, Speaker of the House, and offered by Vice Chairman James R. Maselli. We also have a governor's citation for you. You guys are going to be able to make a whole nice big wall with all the awards you go home with tonight. And that reads, the Commonwealth of Massachusetts, Mitt Romney Governor, Kerry Healy Lieutenant Governor, to Paul Curtin, in honor of receiving Wilmington's Good Guy Award, which is deserving of recognition by all the citizens of Massachusetts, this ninth day of May in the year 2003. It's also signed by Mitt Romney Governor and Kerry Healy Lieutenant Governor. Congratulations, both of you.
I'll get you next year for sure. Thank you. Jim Maselli never kissed me like that. Things are picking up here for the MCs. Next, we're going to have the Curtin girls, Suzanne and Allison, come up and say a few good things, if they can think of any, about their mom and dad. And after that, we're going to go to a film of one of the two disasters that happened here in this country to the now. We won't go there. So after this, we're going to ask, again, I'll address the people and have them move away from that wall after the Curtin girls get through speaking. So here it is, Suzanne and Allison Curtin.
This is for you. Well, we know who's the favorite. I got to sit up at the front table.
Okay. Of course, we had to bring a bag of tricks.
We figured that everybody would come up and list a lot of the activities and events that my parents have done over the years, which, as you can tell, go on and on. So we thought we'd just have a little fun up here. Since, as you can tell, my parents are very involved, but the one thing that I think we're all here and why it's so fun to be around my parents is because no matter what's going on, they always make you laugh and they always focus on having a good time. And I just think humor has been such a great part of growing up in our household, and as well as people who have come into our household. So we thought we'd give a few gifts out here tonight.
You start.
Oh, can you hand me that piece of paper? Okay, so one of the things that I guess my mother is more known for is, you know, she's at all the events, she goes to the 4th of July, but growing up when, you know, if I was out anywhere and I saw a fun pair of earrings, my mother's always been known not to have nice little gold hoops that kind of go with everything. She has to have fun, funky earrings that, you know, do something crazy or they ring. She has jingle bells where you can keep track of her during Christmas. You know, we know where she is at all times in the house or wherever she goes. So we decided this year, with all her work with the September 11th, that we were going to get her flashing flag earrings. So we can now see her even in the dark. Okay, and as since we have some of, or many of my father's employees in the house tonight, we know that my father sometimes, also for people whose taxes he is doing, he tends to slack sometimes during the day. And we figured instead of having the boys take him off to the golf course instead of doing all of our taxes, we'd let him just do that right in the office. So we've gotten him a full set
where he can,
oh, with the flags.
So he can now golf.
We're all
golf and work at the same time.
Oh, wait. Sorry.
No, skip that. Skip that. Just do the baton.
Okay. And as we've heard throughout the evening, we know who wears the pants in the family here. So, I'm just kidding. We thought we'd, since my mother's always
leadership role.
Taken on so many leadership roles, not only in the community, also in the house, and we thought what better way for her to run the show at home. We thought she could have a little baton to lead the way throughout the house.
She has a super shooter now.
Yeah.
Do I get earplugs?
No. Okay, so now, one of the first memories when I learned that my parents won this award and everything, I said, all right, there's one story that I have to tell about my parents. Now, it's good, it's clean, it's good. The one thing that my mother was notorious for was starting water fights in our house. I remember back to one incident when my friend Kathleen Ducey was coming home to meet my family for the first time. And she walked in, and lo and behold, to my horror, was my mother, my father, and my sister dripping wet from head to toe. It all started with my mother. My father was probably on the ladder on the side of the house, and my mother would sneak, wait until he's working right above a window, quietly open the screen, and dump an entire bucket of water on his head. Probably not the smartest idea when he's on a ladder.
And
locked all the doors. And his retaliation was to get the hose and find an open window. So I believe this is how the ruckus all started. So, what we decided to get was
for
the the Super Shooter 2003 for my mother. And we figured we couldn't leave my father out. We needed to give him a little
a
defense.
Matching.
So have fun with your water fights.
That's all.
And I just wanted to say one last thing. It's rare in my life that I'm speechless with a microphone. Normally people
tell you to sit down.
Tell me to sit down, which may still happen. I'm not sure yet. But I just want to say that it's hard to put into words. I mean, I've been working on what I wanted to say tonight for many weeks, and as you can imagine, just from all of you being here tonight, that having parents like this is just, we're very, very, very lucky, my sister and I, and I just want to say thank you for everything you've taught me and everything you're continuing to teach other children, other adults, everybody you touch in this world. And I just feel very lucky, and I'm speechless because I just love you both very much, and I'm so proud to be here with my sister. There's no favorites. We have a very wonderful family, and I want to thank you all for being a part of it and for honoring my parents tonight. I really appreciate it. Thank you.
A couple of announcements I'd like to make at this time. The flowers tonight for the Good Guys table and all the boutonnieres worn by the Good Guys and their spouses are donated by Dawn and Ginger Hill, which is a company here at Wilmington called Designs by Dawn. So they do this every year, and we really appreciate it. And at this time, Ida?
Yeah.
When you go in the kitchen, would you ask the boss to stick his head out the door for a minute so we can thank him for the meal? The meal tonight was by Sal and Oris out of Revere. And Sal Salamone is the boss and the chef, and we'd like to have him come out and say hi. And don't clap as loud as you did for the flowers, because he charges us for the food, so. With this, I get an extra serving to take home. I love this pot.
I'd like to go.
Yeah, if you would, I. Thanks. The next speaker we're going to have up here is Chris Cassidy. He's a member of the WCTV team. And Chris is the one who organized and edited, I guess, and did everything but star in this film that we're going to have shown on the rear wall over there. So if Chris wants to come up, and while he's coming up, if the fellows over the cameras would set up.
Yeah, as Harry mentioned, we have a video basically recapping the Cardin experience at WCTV over the past 10 years. Really, no ceremony would be complete without some type of video, since these guys have been so active at WCTV. I had the good fortune to spend the past couple days locked inside of WCTV's edit bays, rummaging through the archives, looking for some of the videos that Sandra and Paul have produced, and it's amazing how many of them they've actually produced over the years. Actually, there are stacks, like, incredibly tall. Anyway, why don't we show the video, and hopefully you guys will enjoy it.
Thank you. You want to take a minute, Chris, to make sure these people move up here? Everybody moving into the vantage points. Charlie, can you spin around up there? And Ivan? Ivan, is that you back there? Ivan? Ivan, can you hear? Ivan, can you hear me? Someone check his breath. Ivan, are you up there? It's reflecting off your head, duck.
It's very fitting that they would be selected for this award, because they really have used their skills to to help a lot of people. And I couldn't even begin to guess all of the people whose lives they've touched.
None of us are trained television crew people, and yet they behave and they act like professionals, almost as though they went to school for this. We know they didn't, but they worked that well together.
If we didn't have people like Paul and Sandra to volunteer as crew members, so we certainly wouldn't be able to get any of these shows on the air.
When you think of Paul and Sandra Curtin, there's two words, community service. They give back instead of taking.
I was born in a small town, and I lived in a small town.
If you don't produce programs for TV, you think, oh, it's just easy, it just happens, you turn on a button and it's done, but it's not. You know, it's really a lot of work in terms of preparation, and you know, the actual taping part of it, you know, only takes 30 minutes it takes to tape, but it's the stuff before and after that takes all the time.
Paul and Sandra brought like an air of humor to the set. They made it enjoyable. They'd always have little remarks to make. And like when something happened that wasn't the best, they'd just roll along with it and laugh and make it more fun.
Okay, Sullivan, why don't you exit the house? And if you can, just stay away from the house, okay? We'll be there as shortly as possible.
Chief Stewart came to me one day and he had, you know, kind of mentioned, oh, you know, I've been wanting to get this training video done. Do you have any ideas on who might be someone who could help me with it? And Sandra immediately popped to mind because she's always looking for something. It was so nice to get a phone call from Chief Stewart that, you know, he's like, Sandra had, you know, and you know, the other people helping her, Don and Ron, had just left, and how professional they were and how efficient they were and how happy he was. He hadn't even seen the final product yet. They'd just been videotaping. He was so thrilled with the level of professionalism that they had exhibited that he had felt compelled to call me and tell me.
I didn't think that we were doing something on this level, as for saving lives. But basically, that's what he said. That this thing will be worthwhile if they just save one life. And I suspect it's going to, because somebody's gonna remember. Oh yes, you do this, or you do this, or you do this procedure. All outlined on this video.
Hello, we are the producers and moderators of a series called In Pursuit of Excellence.
First, we'd like to introduce ourselves. I'm Cheryl Soderquist, and this is Sandra Curtin.
We hope you are enjoying programming on WCTV. We'd like to take a minute to tell you about our series called In Pursuit of Excellence.
Each month, we'll be producing a program dealing with educational issues. In February, our program will be dealing with the new educational legislation in Massachusetts.
Amanda, how old are you?
10.
Amanda is 10 years old, and she just completed the WCTV course. She can actually work with any of the equipment that's here. She's a responsible 10-year-old, and when children this age, 10, actually 8 years old and up, learn the importance, the cost, and the effectiveness of the equipment here at WCTV, they treat the equipment responsibly and do a fine job. The man of the hour for today. Joe, what is your head swimming from all of this, all the activity today?
Oh yeah, it's just mind-boggling. It's unbelievable how many people came here. I thought maybe a couple hundred would come, but there's a lot more than that. It's just unbelievable.
This program highlights 5 heart transplant recipients. In Pursuit of Excellence presents Heart of My Heart.
To this day, I pray every morning when I wake up for the chance for another day, and I pray for that young man, and I pray for his family, And I thank them every time for giving me the gift of life.
Sandra can do the whole package very well and very fast, too, which not everybody is very fast. She's very fast and very professional.
Better watch out, you better not cry, you better not pout, I'm telling you why.
Why?
Santa Claus is coming to town, gather round.
Without a doubt, there's nothing better than our Santa Claus. I mean, it's terrific, and it's not just that it's Paul. I mean, we have to punch him in the nose to get him to stop talking to these kids. We'll have people waiting outside, and he's still letting them back up. He spends so much time with each kid. He's genuinely interested in these kids. Got me. I don't know.
How old are you, Joey?
I don't know.
You don't know? Oh, sure you do. I bet you're 16. Are you 16? No.
Paul is the jolliest Santa Claus ever. He's a happy guy. He's great with the kids. I think he really enjoys it.
And we rode right down Route 38 to Mr. Spumoni's. Well, I was in the car in front of him with a hatch, you know, an open roof, and I'm standing up videoing the fire engine, you know, coming at us, going down the street. Well, for some reason, the fella driving the fire engine is laying on the fire engine horn every once in a while, and we're right in front of him. So you wouldn't believe how many people driving the other way are screaming at us to get the hell out of the way of the fire engine. I said, but it's Santa Claus. Don't you have any spirit?
Paul's a great camera person for basketball. He does them really well. He is focused on the game a lot. He tends to go more towards a cheerleader sometimes. But Paul, he's kind of stiffed me the last couple of years where he's not shown up at all or has shown up late, and I've had to do both camera and voiceover. And that's always fun to do, but I wish it would stop.
For the most part, I mean, he put up with Allison and I torturing him for years on the drive up to Maine. I mean, it's only an hour and a half, but as a little kid, an hour and a half was like days. And we used to make him tilt his chair back, and we used to brush his hair. So he blames us for not having hair, but he didn't really have a lot to begin with.
Our crowd would always gather, and we would have Halloween parties, and every year we'd have a New Year's Eve party. One year we decided to have a costume New Year's Eve party, and Paul and I got together, because we're built alike, and we decided to come as the old year and the new year. And I came as the old year with the long white robes and the beard and the sickle, I guess it is, and Paul came in a diaper, only a diaper, but he used an entire bed sheet for a diaper. When he walked down the stairs in that diaper, believe me, I almost did what he should have had in that diaper.
I'm too sexy for my shirt, too sexy for my shirt, so sexy it hurts. And I am too sexy for Milan, too sexy for Milan, New York and Japan.
Well, we're in the middle of the show, and I'm on as Mark McGuire, and I think we had another character in Bill Clinton outfit. We were getting phone calls from the public about Halloween, and sure enough, somebody calls and starts a conversation with Bill Clinton.
Please read that name, Mark.
I see Monica's on the line. Monica, how are you?
Hi.
The voice sounded vaguely familiar, and she came on as Monica, and those two, I think, also had a moment.
Well, as you know, my life has become an open book.
No, that's not the only thing. We're plenty of chapters.
I just wanted to call because every time I see Bill, well, you know.
No, you tell us.
It's always a thrill.
As Mark, it's been nice talking to you.
Yes, and Billy.
Someday.
When the world is cold, I will feel a glow just thinking of you. In the way you look tonight.
For a husband and wife team, they support each other in their endeavors, which is a very good thing in a marriage.
Paul and Sandra have the best chemistry out of people, any people I know that I've seen. They seem to be each other's best friends. They get along, they have fun.
They work well together, I think. They've been married for I don't know how many years, but the communication there, each one seems to know what the other's thinking about, and they're constantly leaning on one another.
Now this fun and games is over. I'll tell you, what am I doing here? I really don't care for these two people. He's a pain in the butt, and so is she. And I'll tell you another thing. I'm not going to that party, and I don't know why they picked him. I didn't vote for them, I'll tell you. I voted for Herbie Ruggles, the kid down the street.
Made Wilmington a better place to live, without a doubt. People like that made this place a better place to live. And, you know, they're very special people, and it's a, you know, this award is definitely deserving to both of them.
What it basically comes down to is love. I mean, they totally love each other, so they just work off of that love. You know, everything that they do is for each other.
I'm so glad that I met Paul and Sandra. I admire both of them, and this is very hard for me to say without throwing a jibe in, but there's none here, or not at this time. I congratulate them for winning this honor. I don't think they realize, or maybe they do, how much so many people think of them and what they've done for the town and what they are doing for the town. They have only made my time in this town a lot richer and nicer, and I'm just tickled as pink to be a friend and to be able to call them friends of mine. God bless you both.
If I can be like that, I would give anything just a little one day in the shoes. If I can be like that, what would I do, Lord? What would I
thing I want to add. I've known Paul and Sandra since I was about 10 years old. We worked at WCTV together. Everybody always talks about how important it is for kids to have role models in their lives. And I know for myself and for my friends, we couldn't possibly come up or have better role models helping us out in life. And they're always willing, like I said, to help us out. They're always willing to talk to us. They're always interested in what's going on in our lives, going on at school and everything. And I think every, you know, 13, 14, 15-year-old kid should have somebody like the Curtins in their lives as role models to help them out. And I know that tonight we can't possibly give back half as much as what you guys have given to me, to my friends, and to the community. But I think it's great that we have an organization like the Good Guy Committee to honor these guys, because they really are volunteers who truly care about the community. And they truly put others first, and they think of themselves second, if ever at all. So to both of you guys, congratulations. You guys deserve this, and God bless both of you. Thank you.
The
next speaker tonight is a man who truly needs no introduction. It always works in the movies. Representing the town of Wilmington in the state senate, Senator Bruce Tarr. That was your big chance, Senator.
Thank you, Harry. I want to begin by saying that Representative Maselli and I are both so glad that we convinced Governor Romney to sign the furlough in time for you to be here tonight. And I know that the representative isn't able to be here, but what he would say is at least when he hurts his foot, it's not because he put it in his mouth at the podium. So it's... It's a real pleasure to be here tonight with all of you, and particularly in the great tradition of celebrating all the good guys that make Wilmington such a great place to be and to live and to visit and to be a part of. And it's been great to watch all the things. I want to congratulate Eric for his outstanding letter and the spirit that brings us together tonight, which was so articulate and so well written. And I really want to thank WCTV for that video that we just saw. I know a contract with Saturday Night Live can't be too far behind. It was really incredible. Now, you know, it's interesting. I know that you guys have been around for a long time. I didn't think there was anyone that had been at WCTV longer than Dick Grinder. But I was kind of curious. In the old days, how did you do it before video? Did you sort of make the film and bring it to everyone's home? And Sandra, I was really amazed. Bringing heat to the high school. You have really been around a long time. I mean, was that like... You must have started with little sticks. It's amazing. I mean, you must have been great at discipline if you were good with sticks. I'm just amazing. And you know, there was a citation brought from the governor, but you know, Governor Romney said he also had something for me to give you that you left in his office the other day, and he wanted me to catch up with you and bring you this. And what he said is if the $3 billion check you gave him for Christmas hadn't bounced, we wouldn't have a budget problem right now. So I want to give you that. Think about the concept, a tax man dressed as Santa Claus. I mean, just your worst nightmare in the whole world, isn't it? I mean, it's incredible to think about that. And, you know, before I left the State House this afternoon, I also had a call from the former Senate president, who is now, as you know, the president of the University of Massachusetts. And Bulger and I have known each other for years, and he said, well, Bruce, could you put in a good word for me with the curtains in case I lose my job and things don't go well in the budget? And I said, yeah, I'm sure that we'd be able to accommodate you. But it is, in all seriousness, a great thing to be here tonight to recognize both of you. You know, we live in an era where there are so many challenges in life and so many things that weigh on our minds between global terrorism and the economy and all the things we have to live with, that I think it really forces us to re-examine the values in our life that are important. And when we look at both of you, we see living, breathing examples of that. Not people who think about one particular task to be done, and you certainly have done that with WCTV and with the library and with the Santa Claus effort and with the fundraising, but people who say that every day a part of their lives will be dedicated to other people. And so in the end, it really doesn't matter whatever thing comes up. It's always the thing that we can find you at. And I think that's really, really incredible and a great model that we can each in our own lives find something important and find something good if we just start the day thinking about other people. And you have certainly done that, and every day you remind us, not just in word, but in deed. And truly, truly, it's an honor to come and recognize you. And I was thinking about the fact that there is an expression in the English language. Oftentimes we say that it's curtains for something, and that isn't really a good thing. But I was thinking about the fact that when you say it's curtains for Wilmington, it means absolutely nothing could be better. And I think that's really, really important. I, too, have a citation for you. This is not like the one that you got for what you did on Route 62 last night. This is from the Commonwealth of Massachusetts, the State Senate. I heard Tom Pizarro was part of that too, but I don't want to say it. This reads, be it known that the Massachusetts Senate hereby extends its congratulations to Paul and Sandra Curtin in recognition of receiving the prestigious Wilmington Good Guy Award. And be it further known that the Massachusetts Senate extends best wishes for continued success, that this citation be duly signed by the President of the Senate and attested to and a copy thereof transmitted by the Clerk of the Senate. This is signed by Senate President Travellini. It's attested to by our Clerk, Pat Scanlon, and it's proudly offered by myself as your State Senator on May 9th of 2003. What a great state we would have, and I think myself and all my colleagues would agree with this, if everyone just took a moment of their day and their life to be like the Curtins. Congratulations and thank you.
Sit on Santa's lap. Maybe wish to be governor or something. Who knows? Another announcement about announcements flashing off up here. There's a book running around the room, such as a wedding, which the would like you people to sign so in years to come, the Curtins can lay in bed with their bifocals on and remember who the friends were. Summers will still be there. Not in the bed, but still be there. So if you haven't signed the book, there's a very pretty lady up there, a former good guy herself. Her name is Irene Sharp Brennan. Her name is Irene Sharp Brennan. There's rumor about around town about myself and Mrs. Sharp Brennan. The rumors are true. I'm not going any further. Yeah? Okay. The next gentleman I'd like to say a few words is the fire chief here in the town of Wilmington, Mr. Dan Stewart.
Thank you, Harry. Great job as usual. Senator Tarr is a tough act to follow. That guy has energy. He goes like that all day long. Sandra. Yeah, Sandra and Paul, congratulations on your award. It couldn't, as the video demonstrated, it really summed up your contributions to the community over the years and your help that you've given to the fire department over the years, be it the Santa Claus, various shoots for open houses, and our most recent endeavor, which you saw a sliver of, the dispatch training video. Over 3 days, the WCTV camera crew, led by Sandra, came into the fire department and basically turned it into a Spielberg set. Sandra took charge. She had the firefighters and the dispatchers and all the other participants basically jumping through hoops for her. The end product was very professionally done and will be a great help to the dispatchers and the safety of the town of Wilmington. As Ruth Kennedy said, we were very appreciative. I was thrilled. I called right after the shoot. But I did have one minor bone I wanted to pick with Sandra. When it came time for my portion, I had to tie the whole, all the segments together, and my shoot was about a half an hour of various points that I had to make. At the end of about a half, the grueling half hour, Sandra says, could you do it over? And I was polite. I thought, well, my face is burning off from the Klieg lights. My throat's parched. I feel like I just crawled across the Mojave Desert. But yeah, I'll do it over. And so We did the shoot and finished it. It was great, a great job. I'd also like to at this time thank Ron and Don also for their shoot. In fact, is Don trying to sing? Yeah, you want me to do it over? At this time, I'd like to present Sandra and Paul with a couple of designer Wilmington Fire Department t-shirts.
Oh, thank you so much.
Oh, thank you.
You won't find quality like that on the rack. I was thinking that this morning when I was pulling them out of the box. The firefighters, when they knew we were presenting t-shirts, Lieutenant McMahon and Lieutenant Cochran and a couple of the others that participated wanted also to present a couple t-shirts. So we have our brand new public safety building with all the apparatus. And so I hope you enjoy those. One little tidbit about these t-shirts is that they, when we designed the public safety building, I was opposed to the, I wanted the building to be all brick. And as you could probably see that there's one dividing portion as well as the hose tower that's made of concrete block. Well, anyway, we had the t-shirt manufacturer airbrush in all brick, so. And just in conclusion, I probably couldn't present it any better than that segment of the tape that was presented, but what you did with this tape, you may not see it, we may not see it directly, but someday, somewhere, one of the dispatchers is going to remember something from that tape, and somebody's life will be saved, and that will be a thank you and a testimony to you, to WCTV, and to both Paul and Sandra for all your contributions to the community. Thank you.
Again, to acknowledge a group here tonight who is working free of charge, doing the wonderful jobs they do every year. It's the filming crew from WCTV in the persons of Ron Buteri and Don Laird. Now, for you people in the audience who don't live in the town of Wilmington, let me tell you how this works. They screen this, and this is May 9th. This will be shown later on in the year. It'll be shown 37 times a day. But the initial presentation, which is always the highlight, this year I got the schedule. The first screening, so if you want to see this, come to Wilmington on Friday, November 14th, 3:15 in the morning. It's right after the filming of the Baptist church service. And the Wilmington freshman girls lacrosse game with Wenham High School. So it's shown that night for the first time, then again every 20 minutes thereafter. Earlier tonight I introduced someone in the hall who was a brand new, shiny, new guy. And that's because recently, the last 2 weeks, we had the voting for the selectmen. And we put in two new people, and one of them is here tonight representing the Board of Selectmen, Mr. Frank West.
First of all, I'd like to say, if it wasn't for folks like Sandra and Paul, I think we'd be watching reruns of the Board of Selectmen meetings all the time. And I'm hoping that for many years to come, or at least for the next 2 years and 11 months, you're going to be sure having many competing programs with Board of Selectmen meetings. But one thing that I learned a long time ago from Paul and Sandra that they don't know yet, shortly after my daughter was born in 1995, my wife and I brought our new daughter to see Santa Claus. And what happened was is that we had her all dressed up in a dress, and we were on TV for a couple of minutes with Santa, and then we got off the stage and we were dressing her back in her snowsuit. And what happened was is that somebody came up to us and said, "Excuse me, is that Colleen?" And they said, yes, it is. Who are you? And they said, well, we'd just seen her on TV. They had absolutely no clue who my wife and I were. And I looked at my wife and I said, you know, Karen, I said, we are now known as Colleen's parents. But basically, on behalf of the Board of Selectmen, what I'd like to do is I have a presentation for both of you. It's not a certificate. They don't charge it. They don't give us sharp objects like pens yet. So that's for Sandra. And that's for Paul.
Thank you.
And again, on behalf of the town of Wilmington, we'd like to thank both of you. And hopefully we'll see you, you know, at many more functions for many years to come. Thank you very much. And by the way, Harry is going to be the Easter Bunny next year at the Easter Bunny event. Paul's buying the costume.
Small.
Thank you, Frank. That's where the term Wild Wild West came from. We've been standing here all night, or sitting here all night, listening to wonderful things that Paul and Sandy have done. And the one thing they point out is they've taken a couple of bad boys and made them good.
Oh, gee.
I just met those bad boys in the damn parking lot when I went out there. Both of them carrying a hubcap. Nice job, Paul and Sandy. These two gentlemen are both named Matt. There must be a funny line there, but I can't think of one. One is Matt Nahan, and the other... It's not Matt? Not what?
His last name.
Nyan. His last name is what?
Nyan.
Nyan. Matt Nyan. And the other one is Matt French. Don't they do that right? Why don't you sit there, Santa, be quiet. These fellas are going to return the hubcaps and say a few words, I think. What do you think, guys? Give it a try?
I was very fortunate to meet Paul and Sandra about 4 years ago. And they just change your life when you meet them, you know. They're just wonderful people. Just so glad they got this award, and we tried last year so hard, but just a little short, you know. And just, it means a lot just to see them up here and just finally, you know, they have that, and like all you wonderful people here tonight to celebrate this with them. And not only them, but their daughters are just wonderful people. They just touch your life, just the whole family, you know. They're just real close, and they touch you in every way possible. But I just want to thank you for just being in my life and just being an inspiration for the past 4 years and to continue on.
I didn't really write down anything to say tonight. I never really knew about this award until Suzanne told me about it a few weeks ago. But, well, we're the Mats, and if none of you, Paul didn't finish your taxes this year, I apologize, because we're the ones that go to his office and distract him and go golfing. But one thing I would like to point out is that I often wonder where I would be and what I'd be doing right now, 18, if I never met Paul when I was 10. I started delivering the Salem News and Peabody to his office. That's when I first met him, in 1995. And I think where I would be if I never met him, because he's been an inspiration to my life. He really has been a role model. He's been the second father I've never had. He's definitely the kind of person that, you know, you could go to if you have something to talk about, if you have a problem with just about anything. He's just the person you can go to talk to about that. And I've met all his clients. I know I've been real close to him. Like, we've been both the son, you know, the sons he's never had. And, you know, and Sandra, you know, I know this is a thing for them both, you know. And Suzanne's great too. You know, I've been great friends with her. She's been in the office. I've worked in the office a few times with Paul, and, you know, they're just great people. Just so fun to be around. And, you know, he's a funny guy. Had a lot of fun with him over the years. And I really know that he's told me before that he's the kind of person that likes to be liked. And I 100% agree that he deserves this award. And I'm really proud that he got it this year. So thanks.
Thank you.
in the B&A software.
Thanks. Thank you.
So young. And they're both 2 years older than Senator Tarr. Amazing. Absolutely amazing. Some of these people you've seen in that film, and one was the charming, very pretty lady who's the executive director of WCTV, Mrs. Ruth Kennedy. And she'd like to say a few words. She makes her way to the podium. She probably bought a gift for the Master of Ceremonies. Maybe there's a turn here.
Thank you, Harry. It's quite an introduction. I have to admit, when he first announced distinguished people and he made, I heard my name and I'm like, oh my God, what's he talking about? Selectman West made a reference to the amount of programming we have on WCTV and that if it weren't for Sandra and Paul, you know, their contributions to WCTV, all we'd have left are selectman meetings. And I have to remind him, there are those folks out there that feel that is the best show in town. Thank you. It is my distinct pleasure to provide a little background on some of the, you've seen the obvious contributions that Sandra has made to WCTV through video. And I couldn't even begin to tell you, as Chris was saying in the production he put together as well, the number of programs that they put together. I've only been there 8 years, and I have no idea how many shows they produced before that. And it's just, you know, the video catalog is that extensive. So her contribution that, in terms of video productions, is immense already. But she also had made a tremendous contribution to WCTV in the form of governance. She was on the original WCTV board of directors, which was instrumental, as you can guess, being the original board, to make the whole community television a reality in Wilmington at all. And so, you know, we as an organization owe her a debt of gratitude for her dedication to seeing a concept through to a reality. I mean, anytime you're forming any sort of a new organization, it's tremendously difficult, and she had the stick with it is ness. Hard to say that one, quiet you. To take that vision and make it through to a reality. So, you know, we thank her immensely for that. It is with distinct pleasure that I present our official WCTV Golden Tape Award to Sandra and Paul in recognition of their being good guys in Wilmington. And we hope that we continue to see them as members of WCTV for many years to come and thank them so much for their contributions in the past and also in the future as well. So thank you, Paul and Sandra.
The only reason we're letting this next man speak is because we're told that he's not like his brother at all. The girls inform me that he'd be quiet and reserved. This is Paul's brother, Gene Curtin.
Thank you, Harry. I'm here tonight to talk about a little bit about Paul's early childhood. And I know this is a good guy award, but there is a little bad guy in everybody, you know. And in a minute, I'll be asking the fire chief to please leave the room, and you'll see why. Paul has always claimed that I was our parents' favorite. Why, I don't know, but I will tell him this. You were born on January 1st, Paul, 1945, a long time ago. The second born baby of the new year by 2 minutes. Now I am here to reveal to you why I'm the favorite. If you were number one in the city of Salem that year, Mom and Dad would have had the city of Salem pick up the whole hospital bill and the doctor's bill. And this is what's been held against you, Paul, right from the beginning. So don't blame me for this. You were 2 minutes late in 1945. Now, Paul's early childhood started off at St. Mary's Grammar School in Salem. Nice Catholic boys' school. Well, we had girls too, didn't we, Paul?
Yes, we did.
Paul was an excellent student. When not in school, a constant headache for the city of Salem. Some things we did as young boys, I am almost ashamed to tell. But since Paul always claims he has no memory of these things, I'm going to take this opportunity to refresh his memory. Paul, do you remember the time, fire chief, excuse me, the time we started a grass fire at the Coast Guard station in Salem?
Winter Island.
Winter Island, yes. We had been smoking cigarettes or something. Accidentally dropped the match on the grass. In a few minutes, all the pine trees were ignited. The grass was burning, and the flames were going under the chain link fence, heading for the hangars where all the seaplanes were. Now, that particular day, we made the front page of the Salem News. Sandra, you never heard this?
I never knew this.
Oh, my goodness. Paul, I'm sorry.
Maybe we should give the award back.
Now, it was shortly after this that the Coast Guard left the city of Salem, I might add. Now, in those days, everybody played cowboys and Indians. I'm sure everybody agree with that statement. Paul shot a now prominent undertaker in the city of Salem with an arrow right in the chest. Now, he left a quarter inch deep hole, about an eighth inch in diameter, right over his heart. Now, this undertaker fell down, almost dead, but not quite. And and to this day, he has a scar. And I happen to run into him every Christmas. And every Christmas, he's always saying the same thing to me. I can't wait to get Paul. I don't know what he means, Paul, but I'd be very careful when you come to Salem.
That's why I moved.
Now, on Salem Common is another funeral home story, Paul, sorry. A place called Full Memorial Funeral Home. And one Christmas, or a few days after Christmas, when everybody takes their trees down and puts them out in the street for collection, we gathered about 50 Christmas trees. Do you remember that, Paul?
No.
No. We took all these trees and put them in their so-called backyard. It's now a parking lot at the funeral home. We put all these trees in. Then we had a lot of snow. And we covered the trees with snow and built a fort, and I mean a beautiful fort. And we used to have snowball fights there with the Polish kids in one street and the French kids in the other end, the other side of us, and we were the Irish kids. Well, actually, we were a little mixed breed in our street, but we were fighting them off all the time. Well, come the spring, the snow all melted, and here's all these 50 trees, which the funeral director almost fainted when he saw them. So we had a problem. How are we going to get rid of them? Again, careless disposal of cigarettes, fire chief. Well, we had a blaze in that yard, you wouldn't believe. It looked like the 4th of July. Of course, we ran like hell. Paul, you're looking at me like you don't remember this. Come on.
Gene, thanks so much for coming.
You don't really want me to stop, do you? I said there was a little bad guy, Sam. Paul worked at a First National grocery store while in high school. He also, showing how industrious he was, worked as a bookkeeper at the North Shore Music Theater. And he also drove a cab. Yes, three jobs. Paul really hustled, yep. He was a very hard worker. While he was a cab driver, I saw his cab stop one day, and he was out of the cab chasing the town drunk. Now, What was he doing, chasing the town drunk with his cab running in the door open? He was trying to give him back a $20 tip that the guy had given him for a $1.50 ride.
Oh, good, a positive story!
Then it was on to college. Again, excelling in accounting at Bentley. Paul gave up his dream of being a food store manager. And it was at Bentley that he met his charming wife, Sandra.
Oh, good day.
Consequently, he lost all his knowledge of his past, leaving me to tell his wife all about his childhood experiences. All said and done, I would like to say that the honor you people have bestowed upon Paul and Sandra tonight is most deserving. They both are both caring, giving, and fun-loving people, and I am honored to be part of this celebration and to have Paul and Sandy have me as part of their family. God bless you both.
I thought we were going to have to give back all the awards.
Thank you.
Wake up, Harry. Oh, he's all done. Okay.
He hasn't talked that much.
You will not believe this. When we were lining up the speakers, Suzanne Curtin said, "My Uncle Gene would be there, but he probably would not speak, Harry." Honest to God, she said, "He's very shy." So I come in the hall tonight, and I says, "Is Uncle Gene gonna speak?" She said, "No, he's here, but he's extremely shy. He's over at the bar," which I know he's been over at the bar. And I went over and I says, "Gene," because she said, "You'll have to persuade him to speak." And I went over and I said, "Brother Gene, would you like to speak? I heard you have to be coaxed." He opened his pocket, and he had a computer readout, which he read verbatim tonight. "We have to go now. We can't finish the program. We only have the hall rented till 11 o'clock. So thanks for coming." Really, the program's almost over. Thanks, Gene. We have a letter written by the former principal of Wilmington High School, Mr. Fleming. It could not be here. And I hope it's a short note. It's going to be read by Suzanne Curtin, who owes me now anyway. Then after that, we're going to have Paul Cordello of WCTV would like to say a few words. And I have a plaque that Congressman John Tierney is not here, by the way. And John Tierney, like Senator Maselli, like the Wilmington Board of Selectmen, and like Bruce Tarr's office, always show up. They come, they pay for the tickets, and they do a nice job. So it's almost, then we're gonna have the former good guy give the new good guy his award, and we can retire. Why are you leaving? Gene is not gonna speak anymore.
Push faster.
Suzanne Curtin.
I had actually called Paul Fleming to come to this because my mom did a lot of work with him while he was here at the high school. He kind of wrote it like he was writing to me, so, but I'm going to just read what he wrote. He said, "Your mom gave me my first letter when she gave me that little W with the one in the corner." I think you gave him his first actual Wilmington letter. "Her friendship and wisdom throughout my tenure as principal was and always will be a cherished memory. I clearly remember her hard work with Cheryl Soderquist at the cable television station and what that meant to the high school. She seemed to have a handle on computer value before anyone else did. Your dad was a friend and a person who welcomed me in my brief involvement with the Lions Club, a really nice man who generated understanding. May God watch over the curtains through every day of their lives. Fondly, Paul Fleming."
Mr. Paul Cordello, who runs the fine sports program on WCTV. Come on, Paul, move it, come on. Mr. Cordello. Okay.
Mr. Cunningham asked me to come in and come off the bench and fill in for some speakers, but I'm going to just make this short and sweet because I know everybody wants to get home. First of all, I'd like to acknowledge Harry Cunningham for all the community service he's done. Let's give him a nice round of applause. I also want to acknowledge Chris Cassidy. Chris did a tremendous job in that video, a lot of hard work. And Chris Cassidy, Sandra Curtin, Paul Curtin, you watch election 2003. This is the backbone. They're the guts for the people who can't see, the handicapped people in town. It means a lot. Election 2003, these are the mainstay of the crew. And they're getting a round of applause from me. And I just, when they asked me to comment on these two fine people of Wilmington, this is my 28th year from Wilmington. I'm originally from Everett when I came out here. And, you know, I saw the town develop. And as normally, my son and daughter went to Wilmington High School and on to college. And you know, now with my daughter graduating this week from Middlesex, so I met Paul and Sandra at WCTV, and one thing led to another, and they started to go on the sports forum. But I just got a little note. We had one show that my executive producer, Rick Aronofsky, put together, and it was the wrestler, Killer Kowalski. So he's supposed to show up, and we get a phone call like 7:45, and his car's broke down. So we got to get him in the studio. It's a live broadcast. So Paul volunteers to go down and pick him up. So then it was just like me and Rick talking to ourselves. We're saying he's coming. People would kind of advertise it. And he finally runs, you know, he finally gets it. Paul gets him into the studios. And we had probably one of the funniest programs ever on the sports forum. And if it wasn't Paul's effort, to make that effort to get him there on a live broadcast, you know, it would have been a really bummer of a show. But that just shows the volunteerism and the spirit of Paul and Sandra Curtin. And the best thing I can say, they have made Wilmington a better place to live and be a part of this community. So I guess from the WCTV Sports Forum, Red Sox Weekly, and the entire WCTV Sports Department, you get 4 stars. Congratulations. And to all the previous good guys, congratulations, everybody here. I think I should say goodnight, Harry. What do you think? Congratulations.
One thing to announce after the closing of this program, we're going to be taking the yearly picture of all the good guys, so if you'd stay in the hall, we'd appreciate it. Some of them are too old to leave the hall, but. U.S. Congressman John Tierney was held up in Washington, and he wanted me to give this. He didn't want me to give it. He wanted anybody who could stand up and put a couple words together to, you know, to give it out. I'll give it, give it a Gene. And this reads, Certificate of Special Congressional Recognition presented to Paul and Sandra Curtin in recognition of the outstanding and invaluable service of the community. And this is stamped federally. This is the Member of the Congress of the United States of America. Member of Congress John Tierney, May 9, 2003, made out to both of you.
Thank you.
And enjoying those last few minutes as a good guy here in Wilmington is a former good guy, and will be a former good guy in a couple of minutes. It's Charles Mickey Rooney, who will make a presentation of the good guy plaque to Mr. Paul and Sandra Curtin. And to show you how well this is run, it's missing. There it is.
Yeah, Paul found it.
What a show. What a show.
Well, thank you, Harry, and thank everybody for being here tonight. And after all the speakers we've had, I really don't know what left there is to say, but certainly they're two exceptionally real exception people,
And I congratulate both of you, particularly Sandra. I'm questioning now where you're coming from. You were doing all right till you spoke, but after that, I think it really went downhill. So, and all up until then, too, I really didn't know what you had done for a profession. I knew it wasn't a meteorologist after what we saw earlier, so. But anyway, congratulations, and you're really two exceptional people in the town. Dedicated family and extended family and community, and it's really well appreciated. Thank you very, very much. We'll get the award here somewhere. Well, now you found it, yep. And there is the award for both of you, right?
There it is.
And a list, we also have a list now of the former good guys with 2003 Paul and Sandra Curtin.
Thank you.
And you also now, as you'll find out, I'm sure you probably already know, that you'll be on the committee for the next year election of the good guys. Okay, one question, one favor I have to ask for you, that when I first went to the first meeting, you're the chairman of that committee when you go next year. Speaker Harry Cunningham, as always, his first motion is to have him get a free ticket for the Senate. So vote against that article when it comes up. Thank you very much. Although he does a great, great job, he's a great guy.
That plaque says, to whom it may concern, by the way. Don't get carried away. You will ask me the choice. Ladies and gentlemen, the good guy and good girl for the year 2003 here in Wilmington is Mr. and Mrs. Paul Curtin. Yay.
Give up my time and let my brother-in-law speak for me. We've lived in Wilmington for 34 years, and even today I will say to anybody that asks me that I love living in this town, and I just love the town of Wilmington. We have wonderful friends here. Our daughters have grown up to be lovely ladies and have enjoyed the recreation department, the high school, all the benefits of the town of Wilmington. And so I've enjoyed all that, and I'm really glad that we ended up in Wilmington just by happenstance. I used to teach in Andover. Well, I still teach in Andover, but I years ago taught at the junior high school in Andover. And every day I'd drive up 93 from Medford, take a right, go down 125, and go to school. Do the reverse coming home every day. And I never knew that if I went on 125 and went straight, I didn't know what was in that whole area there. And once we were married, we lived in North Andover for a year, and we were looking for a house. And the guy said, well, there's this town of Wilmington, and I don't know where that is, you know. And he drives us down 125, past the North Intermediate, and I'm going, oh, this is where it goes. I never followed this road. And it ends up, we live on Salem Street, and we're just right around the corner from where I drove back and forth for school for years and never really knew that I was near the town that I would end up enjoying in living in here. So thank you very much. God, it's amazing to watch your life go before your eyes like that, especially on that video. But we love all you guys, and we really, really appreciate you thinking of us and the boys sending letters for us. Everybody was saying, you know, how great we were and all this other stuff. I mean, it's crazy to hear all of this. And we're thinking, God, those guys are so great. We love hanging out with them. And, you know, gee, our friends are so wonderful. And when you hear it in the reverse, you think, gee, we've really had a good life. So thank you very much.
Sandra leaves me with the hard part. Gene? You're not wanted in Wilmington. And that's on the record. Okay? All the chiefs, whether you're police, fire, I don't care. I don't want him in town. He has made up every single story that he told his dad. The kid has been a thorn in my side since. It's phenomenal what he can do. Not one story is true. Not one. But thank you anyway, Gene, for ruining my night. And what all of these wonderful people used to think about me. Okay, now the real truth. You've made a mistake tonight. You really have. Because you have looked at Sandra and I as giving people. And we're not. We're takers. We take everything that's good from all of you. We take the youth of these two guys. We take the brains of these guys. And we take all of the love and friendship of all of you. And we enjoy it. We enjoy every single person in this room. We take from you constantly because we love you all, except for one person. Oh, and my mother, if she were here now.
Oh, did you take my memory?
Thank you all very, very much.
Some of you out there are wrong. You thought it would never end. But on behalf of the Good Guy Committee, we want to thank you all for sharing with us tonight the honoring of Paul and Sandra Curtin for the year 2003. And next year, they'll be replaced by someone else. We certainly hope they're not related to Gene. We'd like the good guys to hang around tonight for a picture. Again, thank you all for coming. Have a safe journey home.